All right, folks, welcome back. Chris Garlock, Michael Redmond here with AlphaGo versus the world. Next game, plowing our way right through all 60 of these games. Hope you're enjoying them. Michael, I think we have a new player today. Is that right?
Exactly. Dan Yifei, Nine Dan, and he's in his early 20s. He was born in 1994.
Mm-hmm.
And he's not a world champion yet. He became a world champion in 2017. So he's a few months maybe away from being a world champion.
Huh.
He won the LG Cup, yes.
Gotcha.
So
that was afterwards, right?
That was afterwards. In this game, AlphaGo is going to go a bit crazy. it's sort of vintage master. It's stuff that other computer programs don't really do very much. We start with the same opening. White plays a star point in the lower left corner. That means that AlphaGo is going to go for the big shimari, and AlphaGo actually played a kakari here. So this is a position where if AlphaGo was white, maybe we would be seeing white play something like this. In fact, I think we saw a game in which this happened, and then, oh no, that was a different orientation. But even in this position, yes. And if black plays something like this, we would get into this. This is actually quite popular now in human play. It's one of the variations. This is the one pincer that black has played here at two, this move. This is the one pincer that makes this really exciting, in which black seems to have relatively good scores in the fight that ensues. And so this is something that people are still doing. And when white presses there, let's get back to the pressing move, sorry. When white presses there, black does have the option of pushing through and cutting here. So this is going to be super complicated with white playing A or B next. So I won't get into it here.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, like black could play here. This would be considered a reasonable move. Well, you know, human players would have a tendency to play a double kakari, and stuff like this might happen. But if black plays here, white's going to press. And people were starting to think already that this was maybe good for white, with the pressing move here working well with white's pincer on the lower side. And that final move could have been on the fourth line, or it could have been somewhere on the third line. I think even Zen was playing like this with white, and it was considered a kind of a computer way for white to play that was very effective. But of course, in this game, AlphaGo is black. So I don't know, maybe AlphaGo is going to be playing something like this. I don't really know what it was going to do, but in the game, white answered, so we didn't see that. And black plays the big shimari. So this is sort of typical for AlphaGo want to play the big shimari. And white pincered here. Like, you know, people would jump into the 3-3 point now, I guess. The pincer here seems pretty normal. Black plays here. In the game, white continued with this. I think this was maybe just a little bit slow. It's not a big problem. Like, this game was pretty close throughout the opening. Partly because some of the moves that AlphaGo played are not liked very much by Katago, actually. And so it goes up and down a little bit. Kicking here would have been a more fast-paced move with white jumping out first. And I think I would have preferred to play this way. Of course, there is the problem with a potential 3-3 point here. But at some point, white can play down to the second line, threatening to connect underneath. So for the time being, white's okay. So like if black plays something like this, white could always answer it with this move. And white would not have any problems. White would be attacking black locally. So I think this would be okay for white. And this is the variation that I would choose, kicking. This was okay. It's a very solid move. And now black plays here. And it's really hard to understand what AlphaGo is trying to do here.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the idea is that it's going to be, if white answers somehow, it's going to be changing what happens on the lower side. So a variation that worked out was that black plays here and plays very aggressively here with the hane. And when this happens, for instance, something like this. And provided black can handle that cut on the fifth line, this is going to be very good for black. So it's just a question of the cut. And when white does cut there, that extra stone that black has is going to make a big difference. So like if white curls around here, black can connect up loosely. In the process of, well, even if black just plays here and here, black will be able to make a living shape. So you can see it is relatively easy when black has that extra stone. It's going to help out in this fight, this stone that black has here. So I think that's the idea. You know, this is one of the cases where I would like to be able to ask AlphaGo about it.
Mm.
But that's not how AlphaGo is set up. So actually, white playing here makes perfect sense if we assume that that variation is pretty valid. So white answered on this side. This was the game move. And black plays a capping move, just giving away the one stone. I guess this is okay. But, you know, for me, it's really difficult to see how those two black stones that are floating about in the center are going to work. And black plays here. Now, this was a point where white played a move that I recognize to be a bit slack and that it also gets a bad score. So in the game, white just bumps against here. And we're going to see it happen very late in the game. But later on, black's going to play a double attachment here. And when black does this, it's going to be a bit painful for white. Because if white plays here, that's just too many forcing moves. It's just too much for black. So generally, white does not want to allow black to get all these forcing moves. It means that white will, when black does that, white might want to counter with something like this, but white loses the whole side territory. So there's this attack here, which is going to be very annoying to white when black actually comes and does it. And I would go back a move to say that white should have bumped against black. And black will cover here, white plays here. Black gets to play the double hane and stop white. But while white has a very similar territory, white's territory is pretty similar to what we had before. Only white has gotten rid of that annoying attachment on the second line. And also, and there's a give and take as far as black's territory is concerned. Like this territory here is a bit more solid than it was in the game variation. But in return for that, white got this cut at 7. And that's going to be the fact that there's these two stones. I'll mark the black stones. There's these two black stones, which it would be a bit painful for black to allow white to capture them. So there's these two black stones that are going to be a target for white to play a lot of forcing moves. It means this will help white when white starts attacking black in this general area, because those two black stones, for the time being, they're just floating around. Mm-hmm. So there is potential for white to be attacking those stones. And the fact that these two marked black stones, white can put them in a tari, and take them in a relative, when black plays away, for instance, white will be taking them in a fairly efficient shape, like if white plays that atari at some point. And so this actually gives momentum to any attack that white will launch on the left side of the board. So I think that the pros and cons of this, according to black's shape, the fact that white has reinforced black's territory in the lower right is balanced by the fact that white will have a better attack on the left side. And so the gain is that white's territory on the lower side is just a lot better than it was in the game. Because in the game, black's attachment here, later on in the game, it's going to be well-timed, of course, because it's AlphaGo, but it's going to be very annoying. So black plays away and plays this move. At this point, the game is still fairly close. Like black did play that one move that I didn't like, and the computer programs don't like it. So white's probably over 54%. I mean, black's over 45%. Sorry, got confused here. White played this move that the computers don't like. So black is over 50%. But it's pretty close still. And, you know, I'm not really finding any big problems for white. And black jumps out here. It turns out that the whole game plan that white should take here is based on the fact that white would like to attack these stones and basically to make a splitting attack, to attack, let's mark the splitting attack like this. White wants to make a splitting attack to attack this group and these stones simultaneously. So if white can do that, black's potential area on the right half of the board is not a big deal, because if white can chase this, I'll just mark the one group now. If white can chase that group off to the right, white will be able to sort of slide into the moyo while chasing that group. So that would be the ideal scenario for white, to be chasing that black group into the towards the black moyo, so that white can sort of just slide into the moyo and reduce it in size while attacking black in the lower left.
It's a good plan.
That's a winning game plan for white. In the game white played here, so it would have been better actually for white. This would also take care of the 3-3 point. So there's a 3-3 point issue that white is trying to deal with. And that is, like, for instance, this kind of thing, where there's a cut here. And it turns out this white move at 3 is going to be a ladder-breaking move or a ladder-making move for the cut. So in this case, white can just capture it in the ladder. And so it worked in that way. It works the same as the game move. It works just as well as the game move. This was also protecting that weak point there at the mark point. So if black invades in the corner, white can play here, and there's nothing happening here. So it's the same function, only playing the knight's move would have been it would have been that much quicker in splitting black on the, like, if white gets to play here but next, it would be a much more speedy way to accomplish that. So the knight's move was slightly better. And here black plays this move. White plays here. And it turns out white is attacking from the wrong side. So this is where white really started to go wrong. And I think black's winning percentage is somewhere getting close to 60% at this point. So when with this move, white should have played on this side. I really like this variation that I was shown by Katago. White plays here and is going to split the two groups. So this large knight's move is really, I like it. It's a very beautiful move. And if white can split those two black groups, it's still a fightable game for white, I'd say. Mm-hmm. It's just very important just to split through the black groups here, be taking some profit in this general area while white moves towards the moyo. In the game, white attacked from this side. Black just jumped through. And you'll notice that there seems to be some weakness here. But how black dealt with that is not really a subject for this video. Like, black does have the attachment here and some forcing moves against the corner like these. And so in actual play, black will have ways to deal with that large jump that black has here. And so the weakness here is something that AlphaGo had a way to deal with. And that given, it becomes very difficult for white to have an effective attack here, because black has already sort of moved straight out. It's going to be very difficult to split through here now, because white's sort of a step behind. So this was the point where white had to do it from this direction.
It's so obvious now. I mean, looking at that, and it's so clear that, you know, white is just actually doing, you know, what it's exactly forcing black to do exactly what black wants to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The complication was that this white group was not as strong as it was a couple of moves ago. It's making it more difficult for white to make that decision, but white still had to be splitting through here. When it's shown to you by, AlphaGo showed how white went wrong, and it was pretty obvious at that point. And white jumps out. White's last chance to attack was to play here. This would have kept white's winning percentage somewhere around, let's see. It would have still been somewhere around 40% for white. It's already a difficult game. But in the game, white played from the wrong side here. In this case, white's just invading the moyo. white still had to attack here like this. And this would still make the game more difficult than it was. When black plays here from this side, it's just the fact that this attack on white on the right side of the board is going to give black control. And now white doesn't have time to attack black very effectively in the upper left. So white's just going to live on the side. But black is still attacking. And white doesn't have a good time to attack black in the upper left. And black just takes it away from here. So black's about 13 points ahead before Komi, according to Katago. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to stop here. This is one game where the variations of the rest of the game, although it's pretty one-sided, it's sort of interesting because black allows a ko in the lower right corner and just doesn't try to kill white. It's very typical of AlphaGo, actually.
Right.
But we'll get into that in the book.
Exactly. This is we're holding a little stuff back, folks, so that you'll want to definitely get those pre-orders in for AlphaGo to Zero Volume 2, which is what these the details are going to go into. But in the meantime, we hope you're enjoying these. Just one little directional mistake there, and down the tubes it went. But anyway, thank you, Michael. Thanks for watching. See you next game.